When you watch a concert, how often do you see musicians performing from memory? I would imagine most of the time. So you may be wondering, should we all work towards playing from memory? How can we make sure it's something that we will actually enjoy and look forward to, and not something that makes us nervous? My name is Susanna, and in this episode of the Coffee Break Harp, I would like to show you how playing from memory has been changing throughout history and hopefully demystify some myths that have arisen. I also want to invite you to take a closer look at memorizing from a slightly different angle today, with some curiosity and openness, so you can see what's in there for you. In case you didn't know, when it comes to the world of classical music, the custom of performing complex musical pieces from memory is more recent than most of us think, only dating to the late 19th century. Of course, from the earliest moments, music has been shared and passed on from one generation to another, thanks to the memory of the players. At that time, before music notation was invented, music changing and evolving was a natural part of the process. Sadly, sometimes the original idea or even the whole pieces got forgotten in that. Later, when gradually more solutions became available to create more reliable trace of pieces from music notation, compositions were becoming more nuanced and musicians started putting greater care into being able to preserve as much of these musical ideas as possible. Most musicians at that time were both composers and performers, and it was generally assumed that a musician who performs without a score was performing their own piece or improvising, as the two were closely related at that time. Performing from memory was not encouraged, as there were concerns that some of these musical thoughts and nuances would be forgotten or performed inaccurately. It was almost a sign of disrespect to perform somebody else's music from memory, as if you were claiming their piece as your own, or that you know the piece as well as if it was your own. From our perspective today, this does sound rather surprising. Nobody would really think that a musician playing from memory a piece that they haven't composed is showing some disrespect to the composer. To us, this totally sounds like a myth, but to someone immersed in the culture of that time, this did cause quite a few concerns. Back then, this was one of the reasons why reading music and being able to sight read quickly was considered one of the most important skills for a musician to develop. Performing from memory was not popular, as some would also worry that a musician who played from memory would neglect their sight reading skills. Can you see how we're entering a territory of another myth here? Of course, if you've just started to learn to read music and you find it challenging, it may be that there will be times when you will feel tempted to memorize pieces, as it will feel a lot easier. And sometimes this may make you feel like you're stuck in this loop where you cannot quite read music fluently, so you're memorizing instead, but then you don't get to practice reading music and it keeps being a struggle. I've actually made a whole other video on this topic, so if that's something you're worried about, make sure you check out this episode on how to make sure that you take care of your music reading skills when memorizing feels like the easier way. Back for a moment to that myth on memorizing and losing the ability to read music. I believe that once you've got a certain level of confidence, what matters most is whether you practice that skill or not. Learning another skill doesn't mean that you're going to lose the one you've learned earlier. This is really important, so please come back to me if you're multitasking. It's totally up to you to take care of what you've learned already and put in some extra practice if you think it's needed. Another aspect of musical performance that was much admired alongside reading music was improvisation, and especially when a musician could improvise a whole new piece on a theme suggested by the audience. For example, a prince or a princess who organized the concert would play or sing a short melody that he or she came up right at that moment, and then they asked the musician to come up with an improvised piece based on that theme. The audience, who wanted to admire the improvising skills of a musician, would be rather displeased to find out that the music had been prepared earlier and memorized, rather than performed on the spot. Probably that's why they so much like suggesting the themes to musicians right then and there. It's interesting how these things can change with time. Personally, I find it really amusing that in the past, reading music and improvisation were the two skills equally highly valued in musicians. But nowadays, you can sometimes hear another myth about these two, and that is that reading music somehow weakens the ability to improvise. And while this myth is not really something to do with our topic for today, I hope that you can see the similar mechanism behind the belief that somehow learning one skill could weaken your ability to perform another. And yes, of course, we all realize that we've got a finite amount amount of time on our hands, and that spending time doing one thing means that there's potentially less time that we could use doing something else. And I totally agree with that. But when I hear someone say that attempting to learn, for example, to read music will somehow prevent you from improvising, it certainly raises a red flag for me. But anyway, let's not get ahead of ourselves and let's now move to the 19th century when things began to change. It was the year 1837 and a 17-year-old pianist, Clara Wieck, later known as Clara Schumann, played from memory in a concert. This is how it was commented upon. How pretentiously she sits herself at the piano, and then, without music, how modest, on the other hand, is the musician who plays the music in front of him. But Clara was one of the first who began promoting this new trend, where a musician was not only appreciated as a composer or provider of the background music, but where their skill as a virtuoso of their instrument began to be admired. This was later popularized by, among others, Franz Liszt, who is often mentioned as the performer who extensively performed from memory and effectively popularized it. Being able to memorize complex pieces with a lot of notes played fast began to be part of the show, and by the end of 19th century, a musician performing with a score became an exception. Since then, a lot of new myths have arisen when it comes to playing from memory. One of the myths is that only when you memorize music you can come to understand it in a deeper and more meaningful way, and that this won't be available to you if you continue to play with music. I have a feeling that this myth may be behind the many requirements for performing pieces from memory in places like music conservatoires, auditions, or performance exams. Do you remember what we said about memorizing music not being encouraged earlier in the history because of the fear that the important musical ideas and nuances would have been forgotten? It's rather incredible to think how from that belief, the world of music came to claim something completely opposite, that only when you are able to perform a piece from memory, you can show to others that you really understand the ideas of the composer. I am really curious to hear what you think, and please feel free to let me know in the comments, but when I see such contrasting beliefs right next to each other, this makes me think that maybe the truth is much more nuanced than that. What I am quite certain, though, is that some people can memorize things more easily than others. You may consider them lucky or not, I think it's just one of the many ways in which people can differ. I, for example, happened to memorize things really quickly, and I was able to do so from very early on. I could hear the music in my head, and I could very easily get the music into my fingers. And also later I was able to visualize some very clear images of the scores, as if they were right in front of me. But at the same time, I am absolutely certain that as an 8-year-old beginner pianist, I could only really understand maybe about 10% of the music that I was playing. And even later, I remember being in the first year of college and playing a 9-page long piece by Bach from memory. And now I look at this music again and I realize how little did I understand. And here's the thing, sometimes you really can't tell how meaningfully someone has memorized their music. Well, you might if you do some rather intense questioning and poking around, but when you hear the music being played and the performer doesn't make any obvious mistakes, you can be easily misled. And I think that some of my teachers were, despite their years of experience. But enough of my story. I believe that learning music in a meaningful and intentional way gives you a lot of joy and satisfaction, and that this is something you can do both when playing with music and from memory. And my goal as a teacher is to give my students the skills and tools that help them on this journey, whatever situation they find themselves in. You can practice this meaningful way of learning right from the very beginning, not only when you're memorizing music, but when you're learning your very first pieces on the harp. In an ideal world, we would all have the skills and tools needed not only to learn, but also to memorize music in this meaningful way. This is something I've been sharing here before and that I will keep talking about in this series. In the description of this episode, you will find the links to previous videos and other resources where I talked about this. So there you have it, a brief history of playing from memory along with some of the most common myths, hopefully demystified. Let me know, have you heard about other myths when it comes to playing from memory or anything else that we discussed today? Does playing from memory make you feel more at ease with music or just the opposite? Are you one of those people who can memorize things easily, or maybe you do find it easy when you're not trying and hard when you try to do it on purpose? If that feels familiar, make sure to subscribe and watch the future episodes of the Coffee Break Harp, as I will be sharing more tips about this soon. And if you found this episode helpful, leave a like and a comment. I will see you here for another episode next week. Take care for now. Bye!